I'm Rick Campanelli. Enjoy the following uncut interview.
In this film, your character Ig is, the horns. This is a big part of the character, but I know it's not the only part of the character. You are essentially, the horns give you this power where people feel compelled to share their deepest, darkest, scariest desires with you.
Yeah. Basically, Ig wakes up one morning after a night of just getting blind drunk and ending up going home with this girl, Glenna. He wakes up, goes into the bathroom, and finds the beginnings of horns growing out of his head. He shortly thereafter, as you say, discovers that people start telling him, confessing desires, past crimes and things, and obviously he's quite freaked out by that, but then he eventually uses that power to his advantage to try and figure out who killed his girlfriend, which is where we find him at the beginning of the story. Ig's a young man going through not only the ordeal of having lost his girlfriend, who has been brutally, murdered and raped, but also the whole town is accusing him of doing it, and he's kind of, there's sort of been trial by media,
right,
and he's just been it's assumed that he's done it.
Now, this assumption made by the town isn't because of the horns, because the horns aren't really something that are seen by other characters.
No, they are seen.
They are.
They are seen, yes.
But they're not really
they're seen,
acknowledged.
But they can't, they're seen, they're talked about, they're discussed, but then after I leave, they have no memory of any of that interaction taking place.
Okay.
And it's or it's like they sort of had some weird daydream where they thought they saw me, and then they're not quite sure what's happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very, it's based on the cult novel Horns by Joe Hill, who, I got to meet very early on this as well, and is just great. I read the book and I was just sort of so kind of, I read the script first, mm-hmm. but then I read the book immediately after, and I was mm-hmm. just like, and we changed certain things, the scripts kept developing, and just it's turned into something hopefully really, really special. I think, because I definitely don't, to me, the strongest thing you can say about a film, or at least a script and the idea for a film, is that there's nothing else like it.
Mm-hmm.
And there really isn't anything else like
Horns. I haven't seen anything like it.
No, you haven't.
No. Well, and I just to see you like this, there was an image released recently with Entertainment Weekly of you in the jacket with the horns, and it's just, it's you, but it's not you.
Yeah, no, I think, I don't know, I mean, I think it's funny, because the horns do kind of change how I look. But also, and weirdly, like I was just saying, they do in the script, people do tend to forget they're there very quickly, and people just start, they'll focus on them for like a minute, and then they'll kind of forget about
right.
them. But no, I mean, I think Mike Fields and Mike McCarthy are the guys doing my prosthetics, and they're just doing an unbelievable amazing job. Particularly, the horns are now, going on in maybe just over half an hour.
Right.
And it's a very, very quick process.
It was probably a much longer process.
To be honest, these guys are really, really, they're
really
unbelievably
good.
Fast, and they make my life incredibly easy. And just, and I think, and they're I enjoy the fact that for this film, just like for Killy Darlings, in the F word, I'm very much, I'm kind of, it's the part that I play that's closest to me, because
mm-hmm.
it's contemporary and I'm English and it's sort of funny and awkward and weird.
Did you just describe yourself as funny, awkward, and weird?
I think I may have. But I love the idea that for this film and for Killy Darlings, there is a kind of a real sort of, hopefully, a kind of transformation.
Mm-hmm. And
physically.
A contrast, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, and in the physical contrast of putting on the horns, obviously you change when you are playing Ig, but do you find that just you, do you carry yourself differently when you are in some sort of costume like this?
Definitely, definitely.
And how do you change?
I'm not. I think it's just. I think with Ig as well, you just sort of. I'm kind of just allowing, I'm listening to a lot of music and kind of allowing that sort of slightly demonic rock and roll spirit to.
Ooh,
sort
what are you
of,
listening?
I don't know.
What are you listening to?
What am I listening to a lot of? I'm listening to a lot of a band called, well, there's a song called Devil in Me by a band called 2220s. Yeah. And I listened to, so I've been listening to that a lot, and just, I don't know. And also Mike and Mike, the prosthetics guys, like, kind of are pretty into a lot of metal. So we're, okay. I'm getting an education in metal as well now, which is good.
Very fun. Do you think you have a devil inside of you? We all claim to.
Yeah,
most of us deny that we do, but I believe most people do have it in varying degrees.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that's, in a way, that's what the film is about. It's about what we can become when the circumstances of our life kind of conspire to put us at our worst point. You know, without giving too much away, there's a moment when basically somebody asks Ig, why this is happening to him, and he doesn't know. That's the honest answer. But he just says, "Without Meryn, this is what I became," and there's a real, you know, truth to that. And and I think what's so heartbreaking for Ig is that, you know, he was in love with this girl, and they've been together for a long time, and then you know, not only did he lose her, but he also lost the person that he was with her, and he knows at the beginning of the story that he knows that he has no hope of ever refinding that in
that
himself
person.
And so, you know, that's kind of where we find him at the beginning. But as I said, it's funny as well.